Hello students, we continue with the next topic in continuation with the learning process. In the last session, we have discussed the physiology of learning. In continuation with that, I am going to discuss the next topic, that is the memory. We are going to discuss this particular topic. What exactly is memory? Actually, it is a part and parcel of the learning process, because the learning is actually occurring in three stages. The first stage is acquiring, the second stage is retaining, and the third stage is remembering. So whenever you are learning something, these are the three stages through which the neural mechanism is acquiring the knowledge. The first is acquiring. So whenever you are learning something new, that will be acquirement of knowledge. Then this acquiring new information will be retained for a period of time. That is the second stage of learning. And the third stage is whatever you have retained is remembered, which enables one to reproduce whatever you have learned at a later stage. So this is how the learning process is continued. So memory is the process by which that knowledge of the world is encoded, stored, and later retrieved. So this is a process. So this is a part and parcel of your learning activity. So one of the phases of learning process is memory. Now, how exactly it is there? There's the ability of the brain to store the information and recall it at later time. So if you want to define the memory process, you can define it as the ability of the brain to store the information and recall it at later time. The capacity of the brain actually is very limited. The total capacity of the human brain is said to be 3 × 10⁸ bits of information. So what the brain does is the information, whatever you are getting in the human brain, either it will be selected and stored, which is very much important for you, or it is neglected and forgotten. On an average, the human brain is storing and selecting only 1% of information which is gathered, whereas the 99% of information is neglected and forgotten. So this is how the learning process is converted into memory. Now this memory is a information unit is, of course, all of you must have studied the physics and nowadays technology bit. So it's actually a bits of information is there, and a bit is the simplest form of sensory experience. So what you have is, say for example, you are seeing a figure, a sound, a touch or smell, and that particular sensory experience is given as a bit of information, and this bit of information is our human brain. All sensory systems send information to the brain at around 50 beats per second. So this is the capacity of the brain, the sensory system. So whatever information we are gathering by all these sensory experiences, the rate of sending the information to the brain is 50 beats per second. So this is what is there. So say for example, you are reading something. So that visual information will be sent to the brain at around 40 beats per second rate. If you are doing some mental calculation, it will be 12 beats per second. And if you are counting something, it will be 3 beats per second. So this is how the information is carried towards the brain. But the average rate of flow of information is around 20 beats per second. So these are the research findings which we have done. Suppose you are learning a new language, about 40 to 50 millions of bits of information should be stored in the memory, and then only you can learn the new language. So this is the some information regarding the memory process. And if you want to store one bit of sensory experience, you require 10 neurons for this particular information. So this is the most important part. So you should activate 10 neurons if you want to store one bit of information. Now this memory is classified as this: the long-term memory and the short-term memory. So this is short-term memory is working memory or sensory memory, and this is known as short-term memory, whereas long-term memory is again divided into declarative type of memory or non-declarative type of memory. The declarative type of memory in the genome is termed as explicit memory, whereas the non-declarative type of memory is implicit memory. And this is the classification which is given in the genome. Now, what exactly is declarative memory? The declaration means the events or the facts. So whatever information which can be declared, and that is the declarative type of memory. So you can remember the events. So say, for example, episodes of something which can be remembered, like specific personal experience, first day of your college, first day of your school. So first award, like that, you can remember lot many events. And this is your long-term memory, which is declarative memory. Then you can remember some facts like world knowledge, object knowledge, language, conceptual bragging. So all this comes under facts. So whatever, say, for example, this is your college and this is pen, this is mobile. So these are the object knowledge, and once it is fit into your brain, it will be always remembered. So these are the facts in which can be remembered. The second type of memory is known as non-declarative memory, which is also termed as implicit memory. And this can be classified into procedural memory, perceptual representation, classical conditioning, and non-associative learning. Now we have seen in the previous sessions, when we were discussing the learning physiology, the non-associative learning is by habituation or sensitization. So this is by way of these two mechanisms, this learning occurs, and it will be long-term memory. Whereas we can have classical conditioning, which is associative type of learning, and here you associate the responses between the two stimuli, and we learn something and we remember something. Or you can have the perceptual representation system. So you have the perception of something and then you can remember that this can happen, and you perceive something that this is in future, this can happen. If you're doing something, this will happen. Like that, you can remember. And this is known as priming, and this is known as perceptual type of memory. Then the most important or very commonly used is procedure type of memory. So whatever skills and motor cognitive parts are involved to acquire these particular skills, say for example driving, say for example taking doing the injection, giving an injection, doing the dissection, writing something. So all these are skills which are acquired, and there will be a long-term memory for you. So this is how the classification of memory is given, and this is very commonly asked in the examination. Again, we can see how the brain is doing this particular classification. So what in this particular figure is having is information, what is converted into short-term memory, and what is converted into long-term memory, and how it can be assessed. So let us see. So this is the information. So all your sensory organs will receive the information. They will send this information to the cortex. Okay. So the storage time, if it is less than 1 second, then what happens? If within this particular time, if you are verbalizing, if you are repeating the words, then this information will be converted into primary memory. So the storage time will be for seconds to minutes. I will give the example. Say for example, I will repeat one number, mobile number. So what you do, okay, this is your number, 9-4-3-3-3. So if you are repeating that number for seconds to minutes, you can remember it. If at this particular time, a new number in between this process, if you are adding a new number, again, the second number, mobile number, then it creates problem in remembering, and you can't remember the first mobile number. So you should have some time, seconds to minutes, verbalize the first number. If it is verbalized, then it can be stored as primary memory. If within this period, if some other number is given, then it may get confused and you can't remember the first number. If it is primary memory, then it can be immediately, very fast can be recalled. Say for example, anytime you ask the number of your parents, of your friends, you can remember some numbers lifelong. Then if at this particular time, if you are doing the reverberation circuit, repetition again and again, this primary memory can be converted into secondary memory. And then this is a very large capacity of the brain, and you can remember these facts for minutes to years, but they are very slow to retrieve. You can remember, but you remember, you have to have a trigger for that, and then you can store it for years. But like say for example, you remember the roads. So once if you go in that particular city by one particular road, and after years together, if you are going on the same road, if you have a something stimulus, then you can remember the everything whatever years before you have seen. But it takes some time, and this is your secondary memory. If again there is a frequent repetition, then becomes a permanent memory, which is termed as tertiary memory. It is again having a very large capacity, and this is a lifetime storage. You can't forget any of these facts which are stored in the tertiary memory, and it is very fast to remember also. This can also be disremembered if there is any disturbance. Whenever it is converted into from secondary to tertiary, if you have disturbance in these frequent repetitions, then this secondary memory cannot be converted into tertiary memory. So this is how the memory goes into stages. The sensory organs keep the information to sensory memory. If it is not important, it will be faded out. If it is verbalized, it will be converted into primary. If it is repeated, it is converted into secondary. If it is again frequently repeated, it is converted into tertiary, permanent type of memory. If some amount of information, if it is not unverbalized, then also it can be remembered as secondary memory. So at that particular time you have not verbalized, but still the information is gathered and it can be transferred into secondary memory. And if there is a frequent repetition, it can be converted into tertiary memory. And this is how our brain is processing the learning. So first we are going to consider the sensory memory. The duration is very short. It's only for 5.5 seconds. The capacity also is very short. At the max, 20 bits of information can be stored. The automatic entry is there due to perception. So whatever you are perceiving the information, it will be automatic. The access is very rapid. Very rapidly you can remember that. And for example, you can remember vision, iconic memory. You can remember the hearing, echoic memory. So these are the examples which can be a sensory memory. What is the mechanism behind that? Is there is a stimulation of reverberating circuits. So this particular information will be repeatedly causing the activation of neurons concerned, and due to that it will be stored for seconds. Or there may be synaptic sensitization if the sensory experience is coupled with painful stimulus. So this is how it can be remembered. So these are the mechanism to store the sensory memory. The memory also can be stored by post-tetanic potentiation. So suppose there are multiple stimuli at the presynaptic terminal, that increases the calcium content in the presynaptic terminal, and that causes the increased release of neurotransmitter. And this particular process, neural mechanism, is known as post-tetanic potentiation. So the sensory memory by these three mechanisms can be stored. So the first two were stimulation of reverberating circuits, second was synaptic sensitization, and the third is post-tetanic potentiation. How we can forget this? What is the mechanism behind that? Sometimes there is a spontaneous or gradual decline in the amount of information and that causes the fading, or there will be spontaneous disappearance of the information from the memory, which is known as extinction. So these are the mechanisms where the sensory memory is forgotten. The second type of memory is short-term memory. The duration is minutes to hours. Again, there is small groups of information, and you can remember like 7 plus or minus 2 chunks of information, and these are known as Miller's magical numbers. So if you are giving 7 numbers or 9 numbers, you can remember these particular numbers. That is the reason why we are very well in remembering the mobile numbers. 9 to 10 digits very well you can remember, and this is known as Miller's magical number. The storage is done due to verbalization. So you describe the items in words, repetition, verbalization. The recall again is very rapid, and the mechanism of formation of this short-term memory is made possible by forming the temporary memory traces. What exactly is a memory trace? Trace is pathway. So there is a newly developed pathway or signal transmission resulting from facilitation of a new synapse, creation of new circuits in the brain. So there is a complete new pathway, there is a complete new signal transmission or road which is created for that particular sensory information. And this is possible due to long-term potentiation, already we have discussed. And the second mechanism is changes in the physical properties of postsynaptic membrane. So there is increased sensitivity to the chemical transmitters. So these are the two mechanisms which occur if you convert the sensory memory into short-term memory. How the forgetting occurs of this particular type of memory is that if new information is replaced by the old, it replaces the old information, then it is possible to forget the short-term memory. What is long-term potentiation? So this is a particular thing which is very commonly asked as a short note in the examination. So what exactly is long-term potentiation? At the time of synapse properties also you must have discussed this, but again I am revising this. There is the binding of glutamate to its NMDA receptors, and there is a simultaneous depolarization of the postsynaptic membrane. This causes the receptor channels to open, and due to that the calcium ions will enter. Due to entry of calcium ions, the postsynaptic neuron causes the long-term potentiation. This also activates the nitric oxide synthase enzyme, causing nitric oxide production. And this particular production acts as a retrograde messenger, which again causes release of more neurotransmitter. So by way of increased entry of calcium, there is neurotransmitter release, plus due to nitric oxide, extra amount of neurotransmitter is released. And this is termed as long-term potentiation. So this is a figure which is can be assessed giving the same example. These are the NMDA receptors causing the release of extra amount of neurotransmitter. So long-term potentiation due to the calcium release, and again there will be release of these neurotransmitters, and this causes the potentiation at the level of synapses, and this causes the memory trace to form. Then after having the sensory memory, short-term memory, the third is long-term memory, which is for hours to years. The capacity is very large, the information is stored according to its significance, and the entry for storage is either by practice, so you repeatedly do the practice. Say for example you are writing continuously, then it can be remembered, or if you are repeating verbally, then it can be remembered, or it can be done by punishment, or it can be done by reward giving mechanism, that is habituation or sensitization. The recall is very slow, The mechanism is that there are long-lasting memory traces. So in the short-term memory, a new pathway was created, which is memory trace. But now this pathway becomes long-lasting. That causes the structural changes in the presynaptic terminal. And they are termed as memory engrams. And the mechanism for making these memory engrams is the changes which occurs is there is increase in the number of vesicles, neurotransmitter vesicles, increase in the number of presynaptic terminals, increase in the number of lead sites of chemical transmitters, generation of new receptor sites, long-term potentiation, and they can remain for long time up to several years. But the formation of these new engrams require protein synthesis. So these are the changes they are occurring whenever the memory is converted into long-term memory. If any one of this is not occurring, then it cannot be stored for years together. The mechanism of forgetting is that you proactively inhibit the previously stored material. So it is very common. So you do by choice inhibit the previously stored material. You don't want to remember that. That can cause the forgetting or retroactive inhibition by subsequently stored material. So new information gathered, so the old information can be lost. Then there comes the last type of memory, which is known as permanent memory. The capacity is very large. The entry is by very frequent practice. Say for example, if you are studying first year, now in your first year, and if you are repeating the anatomy notes very frequently, if you are doing throughout the year, if you are practicing the names of the notes, then it can be remembered as a lifetime memory. The recall is very rapid. It is not affected by brain injury. So even if there is a brain injury, you can remember your name, you can write, you can read. The mechanism is that permanent types of memory engrams are formed, and there is no mechanism like forgetting. So this is again, in short, the summary of the memory process. So what happens is information is processed as encoding, storage, retrieval. So there is an external stimuli, which is sensory system registers it. If attention is given, it can be converted into short-term memory. If it is repeated very much times, frequently, then it is converted into long-term memory and it can be retrieved. If, apart from whatever information which is you have attended, the remaining, all the rest is gone. It is not stored as memory. So these are the phases of memory. Encoding, information of each memory is assembled from the different sensory systems and translated into whatever form necessary to be remembered. So there is an encoding, like numbers are given, compartments are given. So this is presumably the domain of the association cortex and perhaps the other areas which are related to the memory cortex. Then after giving the compartments, there is a consolidation, converting this encoded information into a form that can be permanently stored. And here the hippocampus and the surrounding area plays a role. After consolidation, there is a storage, so actual deposition of the memories into the final resting places. This is in relation with the association cortex. And retrieval of the memories, actually it is of little use if they cannot be read out for later use. But very less is known about this process. But these are the phases of memory. So the brain always first encodes it, then it consolidates, and then it stores. The encoding of memory is done by these areas: hippocampus, amygdala, basal forebrain, neocortex, mammillary body, and orbitofrontal cortex. The encoding of the memory always hippocampus is stored. Select the information according to reward and punishment. Then it goes to mammillary body. And from the mammillary body, it goes to orbitofrontal cortex. Then it goes to basal forebrain. And again, it will be stored at hippocampus. So this is cholinergic projections are there. If the cholinergic projections also go to the amygdala, where they are in the temporal lobe, they also go to the neocortex. So this is how the encoding of the memory is there. So it will be dividing this particular information to different areas. The consolidation is, it takes around 5 minutes to 2 hours, and the sensory information, if you are giving attention rehearsal, it will be converted into short-term memory. If it is stored, then it is converted into long-term memory, which can be retried. So this is how the consolidation occurs. But it can be interrupted if in this particular three process there is a deep anesthesia, if brain concussion is given, or there is ECT, which is electroconvulsive therapy. So if during this particular process, if any of these three processes occurs, then the consolidation of memory is not possible. The regions which are involved in the consolidation are hippocampus, anterior and lateral temporal lobe, median temporal lobe, and amygdala. And the storage of the memory areas are these are the storage. The frontal lobes are semantic and episodic memory. Here, these are the memories which are stored. The motor cortex is involved in the storing of procedural types of memory. The cerebellum is important for storage, again for procedural memories. Hippocampus is new long-term semantic and episodic memories. So here that will be stored. Amygdala is vital for emotional memories. Temporal lobe is involved in formation and storage of long-term semantic and episodic memory and processing of new information. Prefrontal cortex is again important in the storage of short-term memory. So these are the 7 areas which are important in the storage of memory. So that is regarding the complete process of memory, which is actually very complicated and very difficult again to remember. But this is, who is he? This Einstein. So at any time, if you are showing this particular figure, all of you can remember this name. Tom and Jerry. Years before, we have watched this particular cartoon, but still, just by looking at the visual stimuli, your brain actually remembers the name of this. Or you can very well remember some of the cartoon series also. The films. Okay, this is Deepika, Randeep, and the Bajirao Mastani. Sholay, very previous movie. Amitabh, Dharmendra. Okay, so years together, you must have seen, you must have not watched. But just by looking at the pictures, you can remember this. And this is what is your capacity of the brain. Now let us see. This is the question. Factors affecting cardiac output. Define dead space volume. Sensations carried by spinal thalamic tract. Are we able to remember this? Yes, of course, it will be possible. But what we have to do is whatever I have told you, encode it, consolidate it, do the rehearsing, reverberation circuit, and this particular information can also be remembered all your lifetime. So this is the way your brain is trained. So this is all regarding your physiology of normal memory. Let us have some discussion regarding the disorders of memory. If you have impairment of memory, then it is termed as amnesia. The amnesia may be retrograde amnesia. That means it is inability to recall the memories from the past. So from the long-term memory stores, it can't remember some of the facts. Then it is termed as retrograde type of amnesia. It is transient brain malfunction, which erases the primary memory. It usually follows a traumatic event that interferes with the normal activity of the brain, such as strong brain concussion or vascular strokes. So you must have seen this particular movie, The Bourne Identity, or must have read in this particular book. It is dependent on retrograde amnesia. This was a movie, Amir Khan and Salman Khan, where you watch this particular movie. When he hits, gives a concussion, he forgets. Okay, so this is, your films are very much informative. They give you a lot of knowledge of medical. Okay, and this is again a movie, Shah Rukh Khan, where you try to remember the name of the this particular movie, where the retrograde type of amnesia was shown. Then you also have anterograde amnesia. Here the inability to store the new information in the long-term memory or later recall. It usually results from lesions of the medial portions of the temporal lobe and a region that includes the hippocampus, amygdala and adjacent areas of the temporal lobe. There can be psychogenic or hysterical amnesia, which is very rare, and there is sudden loss of memory of all information, and it is due to severe psychological stress, but most commonly are retrograde and anterograde type of amnesia. This was the first case of anterograde amnesia, the brain and the two-track mind. And this is, if you Google it, you can see the case of Henry Mullison, HM patient, which is very commonly known. And due to this particular patient, all of the memory research is possible, or the information is possible. The hippocampus was removed at the age of 27, ended his seizures, but also ended his ability to form the new memories. So he could learn new skills, procedures, location of objects and games, but had no memory of the lessons or the instructors. Because retained memories from before the surgery, but what is the condition? It was this particular anterograde amnesia. HM, like any other such patient, Jimmy could not understand why his face looked older than 27 in the mirror. Okay, so he was not remembering that he was looking at the same himself, but after 27 years, because he was remembering only his face of 27. So that was his problem. But due to the surgical removal of the hippocampus, he developed this anterograde amnesia. This is again a very nice movie, an English movie. Here the girl had an accident, and due to that there is an anterograde amnesia, and the friend of hers tries to remember every 15 minutes that he is his boyfriend. It's a very nice movie to watch, and this is very common again. So he has this anterograde amnesia, Amir Khan. Okay, so there are also again two types of disorder which are known as senile dementia and Alzheimer's disease. This occurs in old age, senile dementia. If it is occurring in the middle age, then it is Alzheimer's. It is characterized by impairment of memory, lack of concentration and inattentiveness, and there is loss of cholinergic terminals. That if you stop nucleus, we have seen that particular figure. And so there is loss of these terminals to neocortex, amygdala and hippocampus. And this is neurotangles, which are termed as neurotangles or tau protein tangles, which are formed in Alzheimer's disease. So that is all regarding that. So try to encode, consolidate, store, and remember all classes. Thank you very much.